What class?
Not your class. Nicole, what class is your class again?
Sports media.
Well, good to have you guys here.
Thank you.
You're going to see a great relationship between the media, Ohio State, and Urban Meyer. Go ahead, write that down. Go ahead, answer any questions for you.
Third row right, Nick.
Tyquan came into a class where he went with all these great players and was kind of behind them rankings-wise. Has it been special for you to see a player have that type of career and be thought of as,
Yeah, I think Sam Hubbard falls in that category too, and there's a little bit extra feeling for a guy like that, like we all have, that a guy that he's a made player. He wasn't a guy that was a highly recruited guy. I remember it like it was yesterday. He came to camp, dominated in camp, and Mike Vrabel, you're talking about Tyquan, right? And Mike Vrabel asked me to come watch, and I walked over, watched, and fell in love with him. And I see the same thing 5 years later.
I want to ask about Chase Young too. He body-wise looks like an NFL kid right now. Have you ever had a kid like that who wasn't a quarterback who has been behind four other players?
He's not far behind. He's getting some playing time. We're not going to redshirt him, obviously. And I don't know the question if I ever had a player. I don't know that. But I can just speak about Chase Young. And the best thing about him, he's a great, great dude that goes to class, takes care of his business. And he's going to be a fine player here.
Front row right, Austin. Urban, you talked about your relationship with Coach Ash before and did on Monday. When you go play a game against one of your former assistants, does your routine change at all? Do you want to make some time to see them? Do you spend any time worrying about the past relationship or see them on Saturdays?
No, the biggest thing we do is change. We're very conscientious about like special teams. He's sat in every meeting here for 2 years. And so just terminology, nothing about the social aspect, I guess, after the season and all that. But it's more about does he know what certain calls are at the line of scrimmage? And I'm a big concern about special teams because he's a very good special teams coach. And they got a great returner. So I'm just, that's where I spend my time worrying about that, the other stuff.
Does that mean that maybe you don't really relish a game where you're going against somebody who's been in your program?
Relish? I don't relish much. It's...
I can pick a different word, maybe.
Front row, Bill Urbanowitz.
I don't know if you've come out of your coach cave the last day or so. I don't know if you're aware of what's going on with college basketball. Is there a concern? I mean, that was kind of an open secret. There was a lot going on there. Is there any kind of concern that something similar could happen with college football? I mean, how much do you worry about the cheating aspect of things?
I used to let that consume me. I don't now. I mean, that was a daily struggle with me because I would hear story after story after story, and a lot of times that's what they are. I hope it does. I think cleansing is good, and everybody, including myself, I get so angry and upset with the NCAA, but the NCAA has got their hands tied behind their back. If you say, don't tell me the truth, then they lie to you. You can't call a recruit for 2 weeks or something. If you do it now, you go to jail. And so I don't know enough about it, but I think any time that there's teeth put into regulation and teeth put into making sure people are following the rules, I've always been a big, huge, tremendous fan of that.
Front row, middle, Dave.
On kickoff returns, a lot of times if a guy's just maybe 1 or 2 yards deep in the end zone, he'll take a knee for the touchback because you get the ball at 25, nice advantage. With a guy like Paris, is it a little different? Maybe Could he catch the ball? Like, what's the restriction is? I'm sure it depends on the game.
I learned this from John Robinson, a former great coach at USC and NFL, is you don't overcoach great running backs or great skilled athletes. You kind of let them. I haven't talked to him about it. I think I trust Paris. Paris, you want to go make a run at it? So Coach Alford coaches him, but I've not had that conversation with him. And I don't usually overcoach him. And I think he's a fantastic returner.
Real quick on the wide receivers, I know you guys run a deep rotation there. 6 wide receivers at the 4 at the 3 different spots. If you have a couple go-to receivers step up, could you parse that down and maybe keep them on the field?
I kind of hope eventually that happens. But right now, that's one of the stronger units on our team. And obviously, the premium we place on blocking, they're doing an outstanding job on the edge. So right now, it's a 6-man rotation.
Second row middle, Tony.
Urban, you said earlier in the week that Jeff Okuda had earned more playing time. Will he be in the rotation?
You have to ask Coach Jones. I don't think he's there yet. I think he's just playing.
And I know he came in, you had high expectations for him. How has he lived up to those expectations so far?
Well, you just wish he'd be a in the rotation yesterday, and he's not there yet. So I know he's very talented. I know his want-to is fantastic. And, you know, if I stock in him, he's going to be a very good player here.
Front row left, Doug. Irvin, we've seen JT try some shots to Marcus Baugh in the intermediate passing game here and there. What's Marcus's ability, you think? We've seen what he's done here to be a decent weapon for JT.
He needs to be a consistent, a strain guy. He's not that. And I'm really impressed here the last few weeks. You know, he had a couple injuries and set him back at the shoulder, and then he had one other one recently. What was that? During training camp. I can't remember what it was. And it kind of set him back for a little bit. And he's learning. He's never been, and I like Marcus. He's never achieved what he can be. And so I'm seeing signs of a guy that we've had that happen here when a guy reaches his ability level, and he's getting very close now. I'd like to get him more and more involved. There's almost on purpose we're trying to find ways to get him the ball now.
And I think you mentioned Elijah Goins the other day, just what he does on special teams. I can see the smile already. We know you love those guys who make those contributions. What is it for any one of those guys but Elijah? Why is he good at it? Why does he succeed there?
He's extremely gifted as far as speed. He's almost 23 miles an hour running down the field. And if you saw last week, it was just dominant. That's a position that Titus Tau started, and then Garyon Conley, Denzel Ward. That's the guy that cuts off. You got to be fast as you know what to get down the field and do what he does. And you're right, I love those kind of guys. And, you know, universities often invest in things. When we offered him a scholarship and he took it, that was a great investment for Ohio State. What he's done, he's going to continue to do too.
Fourth row middle, Coach, this is Andrew. I'm sorry, Andrew is the one that took the photo of you and Troy the other day. But Andrew's got a question for you as well.
When you have a recruit that gets injured, is out for an extended period of time, are you guys able to, you know, offer any help in any way or anything like that, or consult with them or the doctors?
Yes, we, what am I allowed to say? Yes, our doctors talk to their doctors. We give great advice. Obviously, our medical team, we feel very strong. We are the best in America. So that's actually going on right now. We are in dialogue with other doctors in other areas that, first of all, find out what the extent of the injury and then give our advice. And it's been, our doctors are so good at that. So yeah, the answer, yes, the question, yes.
And final question, front row, Tim.
Irvin, can you qualify the job that Greg Schiano did at Rutgers, which was not a great place when he took it over, and you know, by the time he left there, they were building a stadium, et cetera. What kind of job, from your vantage point, watching what he did there, what kind of job did he do?
Well, I think history shows that Rutgers is a great university and a great place, and it always struggled. Or not always, but historically it struggled. And you see a guy, his hometown guy, went home, and Greg's and I have been friends for so many years. And I remember when he was really struggling, and I worried about him. And then he had a couple breakout years, and I was, you know, I would go visit him, and I saw what he built there. I mean, the stadium's beautiful. The school spirit was incredible. You know, whenever you see the Empire State Building shine up with the scarlet because they had a great year, I think they got the third in the country one year. Phenomenal. And I think everybody knows how I feel about Greg, and he's proven it.
And one other quick thing. J.T. Barrett is, 14 yards away from a 10,000 yards total offense, whatever it is, 200 away from being tying the career passing yardage record here is. In a word, how good is he from your vantage point? I know we've talked about him a million times, but he's to be on top of almost every record you can be on here.
Yeah, and he's elite at what he does. You know, like Buckeye Nation and all of us, there are certain games he wish he would play a little better, but that comes life. And I wish I coached better, too. So I think he's elite. I know he's elite. And it's going to be a sad day when I have to send him goodbye on senior tackle and all that, because what he's done for this program and me.
Great. Coach, thanks, guys. Thank you very much.